they will actually tie the number of world championships that the organization has mm-hmm. with SK Telecom. It was a two-year road, and we've told the story a bunch. Last year, they were 10th and 9th, then 6th in spring. Didn't even make very far in the playoff run. And when we've seen the player cams of Faker on stage, he looks visibly upset and frustrated with how the series has gone. Kobe, how does Faker and the rest of SKT now bounce back with momentum technically with Samsung?
That late game poise, that discipline that we always talk about with this team has to show through here. This is where that comes to light. Game 5 of the finals. They showed it versus the Rocks Tigers, and they have to repeat here.
Yeah, and I wonder if it's going to be another Orianna game, because it can swing both ways. Either the fatigue catches up with Samsung, and it's like the end of the Rock series, where they lose the ability to flash the shockwaves, or have they wisened up to it and are very good at playing around it, because it seems like it's less effective almost each game he plays it.
I want to talk about that fatigue, because these are some of the longest games that we've seen throughout the entirety of the World Championship. You know, 70-minute game, multiple 50-minute games. Fatigue with the finals, with the cup, with this crowd?
And it's not just the time duration either. These are emotionally and mentally draining games. Mm-hmm. When you get to the 60-minute mark in games like that, and the decisions that you have to make, you know, the pressure of playing in Fog of War, having to juggle Baron versus Elder Dragon versus Inhibitors, and what decisions to make that quickly, it takes a toll on you.
It absolutely does. And you can see the man on your screen, Koma, running through his notebook, running through his options. We're just giving Bengi a couple of minutes to set up once he configures his play area. We're jumping into game 5. I'm going to put you guys on the spot. We're a couple minutes away from picks and bans. What would you anticipate? Because the question in my mind is, Lee Sin worth banning or taking away from Ambition?
That's a great question, because we just have to look at the last time that SKT was on that side of the map. They threw double jungle bans and a Ryze at them. So at that point, I say it's not quite worth banning, because I'd still rather see Ambition's Lee Sin than Crown's Ryze, but it really would just depend on their confidence level of Faker playing something else into Ryze.
Yeah, I don't think you can ban out the jungle currently. This guy also has an amazing Elise. He's received Elise bans before. I mean, these guys have deep champion pools at that position. The one place where I might see that happening would be mid lane. And as we talked about so many times, Faker's deep champion pool trying to attack the shallow one of Crown.
Yeah, throw more bans at Crown.
The game, put them all out. Throw them all mid lane
bans, and he doesn't play Victor. Just throw one more in there. Leave some junglers up, actually. Maybe even give Olaf over. That would be super risky. Maybe that's a bad idea. But that's something that if SKT feels a little bit desperate after losing two games, they might look to do.
To me, though, you know, consistently throwing multiple mid lane bans at Samsung, yet letting him have Crown, having Victor, which is the champion we can use with Crown, and keep calling Victor Crown, there's a reason, because he's played so many games on that champion.
So comfortable. And Crown used the Aurelion Soul to pick up their first win in this series. Samsung Galaxy have equaled the number of wins against SK Telecom in the last 2 hours than they have in the last 2 years. They've put back-to-back wins on the map.
True.
They came into this best of five with a 2-win, 16-loss record. With this iteration, you know, of mostly this players in this organization, they need to beat that record right now if they want to take the championship.
Must I remind you that they had not beaten KT Rolster in 19 straight games before taking them down in the gauntlet to make it here.
Every single step of the way from KT Rolster to this very game, Samsung have overcome the challenges, and this is the last one. Syndra, Ryze, Nidalee, Zyra. What is next to be banned? Olaf still up there. Something that we've seen a couple of times as well.
I'm just so in awe of this series right now. But that is multiple mid lane bans from Samsung. And there is no way they can necessarily ban out the Olaf and the Lee Sin. We'll be very curious to see if they ban the Olaf here with the Karma being banned already. Still be a pretty scary pick. I'm
throw the Victor. Throw the Victor. Make him play the Cassiopeia. Mm-hmm. Faker, Orianna into Cassiopeia is a better matchup than Orianna into the Victor.
Ooh.
Still scared of the Aurelion Soul, though.
Okay, but now there's a lot of priority picks available, and it's near insta-lock for that Olaf.
That would be expected as he has been banned so much and is the best jungler on the board. But the question would now be, with that Victor up, does SKT take it away with an early pick? Do they go something like Ashe Victor here?
There's your answer.
That's the strategy.
Finally.
All right, so what is the reply then? If Ashe Victor is now locked in,
either Crown tries to go the Orion into it, but I think it's Cassiopeia.
I think I think he does stick with what he has been playing and go with the Cassiopeia as well. But again, I talked about it last game, but we didn't see many of the Ashe Arrows from Bang flying towards mid lane, which is something that they found success on before. Maybe they try a bit more of that instead of using the Ashe Arrows in lane. Because SKT so often wins through the mid lane. Faker's pressure, taking down these early turrets, using that space to get wards into the jungle and play from there.
And I do have to say though, the early pressure of Victor isn't the same that he's been able to output on champions like Orianna. So even if it is Victor versus Cassiopeia, that's not a lane where Victor can take very early control of it, and it does change SKT a little bit.
Oh!
For Gengar's top catch! It's so good against Ashe too, especially preventing the picks in the mid game.
Yes. So, pivot, melee supports. This is something that the broadcast talked about much earlier in the day, how there could be a pivot away.
Double support bans.
Triple melee here from Samsung, trying to charge through SKT to the back line.
Very good you pick up on the triple melee there, because they can stack things that are hard to run through right now. Trundle's Pillar, nearly impossible. Victor and Ashe already very hard to charge through. So SKT, I think it's smart here.
And the Lee Sin kick should be used defensively. Honestly, though, it's very difficult because, Tahm Kench gets to use the ultimate to teleport in very close, and Olaf goes immune to CC.
Well, that will be the fourth time that CoreJJ has played this champion at Worlds. Obviously undefeated, as they had a fantastic run leading up to the finals. Lee Sin and Trundle are locked in. There's no speed ups or amplifiers here for the Samsung Galaxy squad. They've locked in Jhin and Cassio. They'll sit behind that back line of Poppy, Tahm, and Olaf.
CoreJJ's Tahm Kench was so good and so instrumental in getting them here as well. Through that gauntlet that they had to run, you have to watch out for those mid-game uses of the Abyssal Voyage to try and surprise other lanes. Have to be very, very aware in the early game here for SKT.
Yeah, would we pivot back to a Braum in this lane instead of a Nami, which would be the other expected pick from SKT? I can see it as far as wanting to get a really, really hard to kill frontline when Cassiopeia and Jhin are the main damage coming out from Samsung. Really almost defaulting back to some of the stuff we saw several months ago.
You gotta love the fact that this support AD carry meta, how it's adjusted and adapted throughout the course of the World Championship. The final game, a couple extra support bans, and we're back to Tahm Kench versus Braum in the bottom lane.
We've come full circle.
We did it. This means there's only, we can't play more games than this. The circle is complete. Now who will win?
The cycle of melee and range supports.
Of course, the two bans didn't hurt.
Now, what do we think about these two team compositions? It feels like there's a little bit more damage on the side of the Samsung squad, but a lot of utility in SKT. I mean, they're still very heavily focused on mid and ADC.
Very evenly matched, these two compositions right here.
They have almost exactly the same style. You have really tanky champions in the top lane, melee supports, AD and high damage mids with physical damage junglers. They are so close to each other as far as overall style goes, that it's really just going to be about who the better team is.
In terms of lane matchups, early game, does that favor one particular composition more than the other? Because that was something that was very pivotal in game four, and one great team fight broke open the scaling option that SKT had.
It really depends on how good Bang's Ashe is against Ruler's Jhin right here, because I think Cassio can shove in Victor, and early on, the Trundle Poppy is the Trundle favorite matchup, so it's back and forth in a lot of different lanes.
Definitely excited to see about the early jungle pathing as well, because the opportunity is definitely here for Bengi to storm once again back into the game when SKT need him most to save the series.
B Bengi was the big reason why SK Telecom took down the Rocks Tigers. Will he be a big reason for SK Telecom to win their third world championship? You guys know how to vote. It was down to 52% and 48%. Who takes the title? Who will be your world champion?
Or will these most unlikely of underdogs in Samsung upset the defending champions and touch the Summoner's Cup?
Unbelievable. The way that the legacies will be changed based on the results of this map. You could have world champion Core JJ after this game. Everyone on Samsung, those players could call themselves world champions. Duke could win his first world championship. Faker and Bengi, their third.
Ruler's rookie year.
So much. Yeah.
And again, it's just that storyline that, you know, both of these teams have very, very, very different backgrounds. But all of that feels in some way insignificant right now because of the context of this World Championship, because of the craziness of groups, the ridiculousness of Rocks versus SKT, and now Samsung have stepped up to the challenge. Something that they were counted out from. They were not meant to do this by all logic coming into the games.
The arena is dead silent right now in anticipation for this game to start.
Ha! Proved you wrong now that they start making noise. I agree with you as far as the early jungle paths go, though. Look at this. Both junglers actually doing buff starts because I think they're guarding against the big play from the opponent, trying to go and catch them at a second buff.
We touched on this what feels like 5 hours ago, but technically, Faker's Victor has a significantly better win-loss ratio than Crowns. Again, that helps being on a more winninger team. And we'll see how Faker handles Victor against what is considered to be the world's best Victor.
SKT are the winningest team in world's history. Yeah, all that matters is this one game.
Exactly, and they've also lost more games at this World Championship than ever before. This is now their sixth loss was what happened last game, but still, just matters how many games they're able to win.
Crazy to think that Samsung have lost 3 games to this World Championship to get to this point. A slightly favorable playoff bracket where they just ran through it. Faker this time round gets his hands on one of those mini Raptors.
Yes, Faker versus the mini Raptors. Success.
He's technically 1-2. He's got a losing record against them. Just saying. From what we've caught on camera.
All right, there's the first jungler spotted on the ward. Ambition is seen at the Raptor camp. And Bengi's moving bottom while the mid lane are training.
Who's going to get it? Crown's looking Noxious Blast.
Going to go all in and kill him.
We've got to jump bottom. Ruler is going to be in trouble. Can score JJ's running for his life. First blood picked up by Wolf.
Wow! Bengi comes back into the series, grabs first blood for the bottom lane, and we'll see if Ambition has anything to say about it. He's got the Scuttle Crab, and he's going in to tax the Wolves.
Unbelievable right there, being able to pull off first blood. It goes to Wolf, however, which isn't the greatest distribution of gold, and Faker's down both summoner spells. Here comes Ambition!
Ambition's running in, gravity fields up. That will stun Ambition under the tower. Kill is secured, but Ambition loses his life.
Bengi got in experience range there, and he's going to be able to take up these minions.
Here comes Wolf!
More action!
Here comes Bengi and Wolf. Crown's going to sidestep and dodge. He will get stunned up by the concussive blows. SK Telecom, 3-1.
And they jump out the gate, countering Samsung's play in the mid lane. Bengi arrives. Wolf is the main roam in that play.
Game 5 in the finals, and the action is breaking through. Faker gets a gravity field off to lock in the extra kill here on Ambition. Then the roam from Wolf so quickly.
Crown wanted to stick around to make sure the wave gets jumped in the turret, and he should have been straight back. Not calling the miss on Wolf right there, and everyone was expecting Wolf to be in base after what happened in the bottom lane, but after getting first blood, he roams on the melee support. Those are the guys that make the roam plays happen.
We come back to the game, and Bengi is still inside of Samsung's jungle, recalling as he's counter-jungling, has smited Samsung's Wolf spirit.
Again, level 3.
Oh, a lot of damage onto Faker. Those Twin Fangs chunking him down. Bengi's still not left the jungle, for the record. He's now clearing out the Gromp, farming up away, and the fan vote looking to the underdogs, and Samsung Galaxy.
One of the most insulting things is a jungler smiting your Wolf Camp spirit that early in the game. As it will see, as soon as Ambition goes back to farm, and Ambition didn't have vision, so he didn't take that opportunity to go in and counter jungle Bengi, even though they already had the vision down. They already had pink wards. So Bengi gets away with it. He catches up in the experience, and he's going to be able to farm his own jungle.
I agree. And the other thing we do have to keep track of, though, is when Ambition ran for the gank in mid lane, he did get some wards in SKT's jungle. So it's good of Bengi to make it all the way back to the blue buff, try and reestablish control over there. Because with the melee supports, we're much more likely to see ganks in the bottom side, which means ward control in that half of the map becomes more important.
Talking about all those wards, there is a pink ward from SKT inside, just behind the Wolf Camp. Ambition moving closer and closer to it. We'll see how long that one does actually last. Duke was being pushed under his turret by Cuvée. Cuvée has just started to back away as Duke's completed that teleport, even on CS in those two lanes.
And Ambition was seen by the Wolf Spirit. There was a ping there for SKT, so they know he's on the top side. He's actually making a play right now, kind of born of desperation, since there are no camps for him to pick. Even though the Wolf Spirit did see him, he goes away, he steals the Krugs, and he might go for the gank on Duke to burn the flash.
So much counter jungling going on right now, and Ambition level 6 is an incredibly strong duelist. What do you want to make the counter gank onto Bengi? He's expecting Bengi to be in that brush. Would they collapse? It would be a close fight. Fake,
I mean,
not
he can
yet
safeguard
level 6
pretty quickly.
2v2, Bengi is going to ward hop over. Does not opt in to the engage. Too much on the line, too risky. Bang is being pushed away. Rula and Core JJ using that ranged poke, those tongue lashes to their advantage. They're playing fairly defensively. Good bounce.
Yeah, Wolf taking the harass. Samsung need to be able to get some advantages in that lane. The Jin and Tong pinch pick, because you want to be able to unlock for JJ to roam. That's what he's been so successful at with this team.
Pink Ward still sitting in that little banana bush area to the left of mid lane. Crown got blue buff. He's actually done fairly well at William Faker, but unfortunately he's donated a kill thanks to that tower dive in the end.
And notice how both junglers are hovering around the mid lane for that action, fighting over the Raptors now, as Bengi claims the small ones.
Yep, throwing it back and forth.
He doesn't have smite though for big.
So Cuvée loses the trade thanks to the subjugate. And Duke is already winning this trade. Tiamat into Barmy Cinder. No real surprise. A slightly worrying, you know, transition here for Samsung Galaxy.
Welcome to the Taco Show on the top lane. With that Tiamat, unless they're sending people the game, he's going to be shoved in for the rest of it.
Oh, sneaky play here from Bengi to try and steal this away under their nose.
Back if he needs to retreat.
Fight,
what a lot of damage onto Bengi. Crown posted up for this one. Flash away. Curtain call still in range. The Miasma will block the movement. Curtain call. Kill for Rula.
And that means Rula gets red as well. So a total backfire on that invade from Bengi. They didn't have the wave with which for Faker to support him. So uncharacteristically, Bengi makes a big game 5 mistake.
Incredibly bold and, you know, unwarranted play there from Bengi to steal away that red. As you said, Faker was not making any move to move up and support that play. Huge punish there from Samsung as they're gifted the kill and red buff onto the bottom lane.
Bengi giveth and Bengi taketh already in the first two big plays in this fifth and final game. So serrated Dirk, a kill under Ruler's belt, and now red buff for next little bit of exchanges. Core JJ level 5. Does not have access to that Abyssal Voyage just yet. Bang and Wolf assume vision control. Actually placing two of those invisible wards in the Tribrush, making sure it's doubly covered.
And Core JJ keeps getting cut off right here. He was a little lucky, actually. They didn't have vision on Ambition because they put all in.
Ooh,
whiff on the arrow.
This goes wide. Unbreakable wall comes up and Wolf backs away. So traded two ultimates. Really for an opportunistic attempt.
Also showed the jungler, so Bengi's trying to make the most of his time down here by taking the dragon, but that means Ambition, every time he sees Bengi opposite side, immediately he can go in and tax. This is actually something that Meteos talked about in his interview after their game versus Samsung. He was almost scared to make moves at times because Ambition would tax you so hard every time you show on the map.
Yep, and now the question would be, would they ever think about diving Duke? They would need to roam Crown up there as well, or is he just here for the CS? You'd expect just the CS.
Be the case.
Maybe mid lane as they're starting to rotate down, but yeah. Faker taking the blue, so not currently there to be dope.
The best timing on a mid laner is right to gank is right after they pick up the blue buff, because it's right when they want to start burning their mana to shove a wave, and oftentimes that means their skills are on cooldown, but nowhere close to that gank right now.
And let's talk about the mind games of the levels of the vision war for a moment here, because they know that Ambition was just on the top side. So you have to assume that there are wards in there as well and work around that information that's been given over. Now, Banky again going in on Crown.
Very aggressive. Uses full complement of abilities. Kicks Crown away, and Crown's going to be all right. But there's a lot of exchange going down between Bang and Wolf.
It's a lot of harass, too. This actually puts him in kill range for Faker. And if he doesn't recall to go back to base, he's going to heal up a decent amount from his refillable potion and his last hits. So should be generally okay since Faker's recalling.
Yeah, doesn't seem to be pressured just yet. Even game as far as gold is concerned. SKT, they were the first ones to make those plays, get the kills on the board. Bengi did overreach, actually much like Ambition. So both junglers this game have gifted a kill to their opponents. And they got to be very careful as that continues to play out. The game is seemingly happening on the bottom half of the map. There's a Missile Voyage. He's going to deliver Claw JJ and Ambition. Flash away from the back. He gets gobbled up from the tongue lashing. Will go down. Root in place. Not going to lock down Wolf. But Crown has roamed. And Wolf gets the kill.
And that's the Core JJ playmaking right there on Tahm Kench. The instant he hits level 6, he brings Ambition in and the roam from Crown. Now, though, it's going to be a race to see who can get the first turret down.
Teleport being used there by Cube to try and defend the mid turret, and Samsung will capitalize with the objective on top of it. Finally, they're attacking the bottom lane, which SKT have lost 3 games to very strong AD carries. And as they talk about on the analyst desk, DeFicio mentioned one of the ways through SKT is through the bottom lane.
2,000 gold lead. They have the kill advantage, first tower blood, and it all stems from this phenomenal tower dive.
Yeah, they don't actually see if they're even able to bring in multiple people. Wolf and Bang can't get away in time. Love the flash follow for the eat by Core JJ.
The Tahm Kench pick, once again, so huge for Core JJ. And as you talked about, the roam from Crown at the same time. This was a mistake that we saw earlier in the series from Sanxum. They made a play in the bottom lane, but they didn't coordinate all members. This time around, they bring the mid lane guns and they get the extra kill plus first turret gold.
Yeah, and the fact that they didn't lose any of their other turrets is great, but they did sacrifice some damage on them, because when they burn the top laner's teleport to defend mid lane, they also lose chip damage on the top lane turret. So we're at an interesting inflection point of the game right now, where if Samsung can take control of the top side of the map and make sure the mid lane and top lane don't get pushed in as hard, then they can kind of negate the chip damage they took on their turrets and try and really expand this gold lead quickly.
And now the real test is on SK Telecom. They've lost the 2 games. In game 4 of this series, they fell behind, but not this early and not this much. Samsung have now played more aggressively. Cubase even putting a lot of damage onto Duke.
And not in this way. All of the kills there went over to Samsung's carries. 2 for Crown and 2 for Ruler. The Jhin loves getting so much early armor penetration with that gold. And he's definitely set up to make plays, but SKT looking to go on the offensive.
OJJ is devoured.
Ambition is here.
Ambition's running in, teleport coming down for Cube doesn't have his available, but Core JJ is already killed. Faker was there to join the party. Cube continues to pressure.
Careful,
in the
buddy.
Bottom inner turret, and Bang's Ash Arrows have not been the greatest thus far.
Well, he wanted to hit the arrow to stop Jhin's ultimate, but Faker charging at your face is also going to cause him to pack up early and leave.
Yeah, they definitely doubled down on that interrupt, but I will say this time it was SKT who was faster on the roam, and Core JJ's aggressive play on Tahm Kench is punished pretty well there by SKT to equalize those turrets.
How fitting with these two teams down to the game 5 going blow for blow, play for play. Still though, Samsung with a slight edge.
Yeah, it's starting to feel more and more like a game of chess. Each move costing units, costing objectives. And at some point, you give away something that is too important. We're 15 minutes in, which team will be the first, because it's still dead even.
And it's even more analogous to chess in this game because they picked kind of the same pieces. the super tank top lane, the physical damage jungler, the magic damage, high DPS maves. Like, it's all kind of fitting together here for these guys to just try and outplay each other with a lot of the same tools.
Brown throws down some damage onto Bengi as he escapes. Faker and Wolf defending that pink ward. Now, next dragon is Cloud. It's up in 40 seconds. SKT already have one.
Now, with the also AD carry split pushing right now, yes, it's technically a 1v1, but the Tahm Kench in mid lane has the ability to get there so quickly. With both top laners no teleport, the Tahm Kench Abyssal Voyage play is huge, and they're actually pinging.
Oh, Ruler's in trouble. Bang's gonna throw down the Enchanted Crystal Arrow. That gets the stun. Flash and heal used by Ruler. Bang manages to turn that one around. Bang gets the win.
Interesting that the Tahm Kench and Cassiopeia didn't decide to join that play. I think maybe because Ruler had been taken so low, they just decided to call it off.
Oh, is this gonna turn it around?
They go for it now. Now they go for it. They delay.
Here comes Core JJ and Ambition. It's all about the long
Gorgeous
game.
Gorgeous play.
Bang will get right hit him. Down.
Man.
Unbelievable.
The patience on the Tahm Kench right there. Thinking that, oh, if they're not going to go the first time he goes aggressive, maybe he's safe. Wolf roams down to the mid lane. As soon as they say Wolf in the mid lane, they know they can't counter the Tahm Kench roam. Beautiful.
And SKT can't even take that mid turret. Now they've grouped up. Okay, Vision is being set up in the bottom half of the map. Dragon is an opportunity for SK Telecom as Duke is wailing away on the outer turret. SKT started this one off. There will be no contest from Samsung Galaxy. Instead, they kept their ADC and jungler up top. I think they should get that tower. Yes, we'll take it very short.
The tables have turned. This time around, it's SKT racking up the extra early Drakes, whereas it's Samsung with the early gold lead. Even after Faker equalizes this mid turret, they will sit on the slight early gold lead. But the only difference is two Cloud Drakes for SKT. Now they're about bottom though, and Yubei!
Yubei's gonna try taxi away. Gets chomped before he can fire the verdict.
And that could be a problem. This is what happened when Duke had the Trundle in their winning games. He just shoves you into the turret, ults you, tanks the turret, and it's a free dive unless you're there to return fire. No Tahm Kench ultimate to lend assistance in. SKT actually jump ahead in gold, as well as having the double Cloud Drakes, which enabled him to make many more roams.
Another play here for Wolf.
It's going to get gobbled up by Core JJ. There's that counter to Ash that we talked about. That Ash Arrow looked like it was going to hit until the Devour.
And the big deciding factor is, I mean, we've had so many plays in this game. Both teams are trying to make all these cross-map plays and these counters. With the double Cloud Drake now, SKT are fitted out with rocket boosters to make cross-map plays. And they can answer and punish much, much easier.
No room for error for Samsung Galaxy. Luckily, they've got long-range engage. Ambition looking for Faker. Faker's rooted down. What? Curtain Call will miss a stationary target. The Devourer comes up. That will at least get an escape route. Faker, a little lucky Ruler didn't connect that shot.
Yeah.
Now the tower's under pressure.
Trying to zone out the engage from the left side while the minion wave comes up there, but the Victor, very good at clearing waves.
Meanwhile, we're seeing the farm being traded by the top laners in their split push. And really, both teams also trading deep vision here in the bottom side of the map, as the Drake is really the point of contest. So that's where most of the resources are going to be used.
Well, it was another Cloud Drake, Toby. So if SKT already have rocket boosters with
the
two
last.
Of them.
This coming Cloud Drake is the last Cloud Drake of Worlds 2016.
And our stats guy Spellzy was really trying to get us to mention a stat about Cloud Drakes, because SKT have gotten way more Cloud Drakes than any other Drake at Worlds. Fitting
Great.
Somehow that they might get you triple Cloud Drake in the final game.
See, now you spawned all the conspiracy theories.
RNG.
The scripts in the back saying, Cloud Drake again, let's go. We want SKT to run faster.
How do you overthrow a dynasty? Flood them with Cloud Drakes.
Well, Samsung have to still overthrow that dynasty. They have to overcome in game 5. Bengi, not going to follow on to that, Craig. Again, this is a game of inches at the moment as we're getting close to 20 minutes.
Yeah, Yubei immediately puts up the steadfast presence there, so Bengi would be denied if he tried to go in and stuck on the other side. Still could have taken it and smited it, I guess, but not going to play risky after he was punished at the red buff early on.
And that steadfast presence could become so pivotal when you look at the low mobility Cassiopeia and Jhin. if Bengi's looking to dive in there and find a target, could be denied. And if that is not available, obviously the safety net of poor JJ's Tahm Kench. They've got a very well-crafted sort of multiple safety net team composition here on the side of Samsung.
Yeah, and something that SKT has struggled with this series is actually closing games in which they have an advantage. The Tahm Kench and the Cassiopeia is going to make it even harder for SKT to close this game if they are able to extend their lead.
So many opportunities as both teams have drafted many playmaking abilities here for the mid game.
This has been the most even game that we've seen the entire series. It's a very different team composition when you look at the two duos. So Kobe, what are we looking at in the next few minutes? Both teams have got strong initiation tools. There's a dragon coming up in a minute and a half, but it's not the juiciest to fight over. Like, what do you look for if you're these teams?
I expect someone to die over a pink ward or over sweeping a trinket ward here very soon, because both of these teams know the importance of setting up that vision.
Yeah, I think that's how a Samsung player would die. If SKT dies, it's because Core JJ would come in with a friend on an Abyssal Voyage with Tahm Kench, since we have a 1-3-1 right now. So either it's someone trying to clear ward getting hit by an Ash Arrow, or someone in SKT going for an aggressive play and getting countered by Tahm Kench.
Or a Jhin ultimate, which can serve a similar purpose to the Ash Arrow and landing the slows for the chase down. Now, another thing to keep in mind, because these team fights are very fun to theorycraft. With all
for JJ, he hasn't used the Grey Helm yet. Glacial Fissure slows down Samsung Galaxy. It was SKT that initiated. The Crystal Arrow has already been used. No teleports or follow-up. One flash from Core JJ.
Both mid laners still have their ultimates, though, and both top laners as well. Similar amount of tools burned on both sides.
That's just going to slow the game down once again. Samsung Galaxy jumped on as they're just trying to farm and clear out that mid lane wave.
All right, so if we do see the engage, once again, setting up those key tools for each team. The Keeper's Verdict for Qubit. Yeah, exactly. Somebody could die there.
Let's see if Samsung will lose somebody over Pink. Well, there's not enough support.
Yeah, exactly. Nobody else is converging.
I just wanted to see it happen.
Cuvée's Poppy, the Keeper's Verdict, knocking out, you know, half of a team, basically, and buying the numbers advantage, basically, has been huge as well. So it's not just about picking people off. It's also about separating members within a team fight once it spawns.
Absolutely agree. And as far as the map right now, oh, they might catch Faker.
Faker's the target, but he tries to turn it around. Defensive flash from Ruler. Faker is shut down. Ruler gets the kill. Teleports completed for Duke as well as Cuvée. Unbreakable is up. Ash Arrow stuns up. Core JJ, that's not the most important target. Oh. Petrifying Gaze flashed away from. Duke is caught down. Core JJ licks him to death. The tower is the focus, and Samsung have the advantage.
Massive catch, and it's as Faker is trying to get aggressive onto Ruler. He does not have the burst this time. They get the mid lane turret, and they can help bring back the speed balance with the Cloud Drake if they're able to take this one.
Definitely going to be able to take this one. I think this is full Samsung territory after those two kills, and they are going to be able to claim one for themselves. The interesting thing about the Cloud Drakes, though, you can't take away any of the speed of your enemy for these dodging of the ultimates. So now both teams have the fast feet, right? Extra Cloud Drake for dodging Ash Arrows could mean the difference between a pick for SKT and then avoiding certain death.
Jhin ult to try and secure blue. Have to question whether that one's worth it, but let's watch this pick one more time. Faker steps on a trap and just gets rooted as Ambition comes in, but he's also moving forward before he has the support of the rest of his team. Faker getting caught out of position, critical moment here.
And instantly, this turns into every single member of both teams headed mid lane for that party. Samsung arrived first, and they also go for the turret dive to grab the last one. Cuvée with a nice little flash move at the end there to snag him.
Petrifying Gaze was even just a little bit short.
Yeah, missed everyone.
Could have turned even more in favor of Samsung. No flashes for any members of SSG right now. So you could expect the next few minutes to slow it down. They've got a minor gold lead. It's not worth the risk of getting caught out.
Yeah, I agree with that. But I also want to point out that SKT doesn't have the same lack of flash punishing skills they've had with their previous team compositions. It's not like Faker can just flash in and one-shot you with Orianna when you're down flash. Here, even if you do get hit by an Asher without flash, if Core JJ's close, he's just going to devour you and bring you to safety. So the playmaking from SKT is somewhat muted and blocked by the stuff like the Olaf and the Tom Kench that Samsung's been able to put together.
Samsung have been able to get a lot more control in their games. With each game in the series that is played, they seem more together, more reactive, and more on the same page. Not the same level of mistakes that allowed SKT to accelerate what they run into.
And even though there is this gold lead for Samsung, it's so slight that it's more about completing items and actually getting back out onto the field.
Ambition didn't even use his Ragnarok. New Core JJ was in range, and that's exactly what happens. No flash, doesn't matter.
Very closely matched here as they go in for a slow onto Wolf. And any extra damage onto the support, though, is hard to regenerate. They also draw out an ultimate from Bengi. Now, that is one of the big healing tools for this SKT squad, too.
I agree with you. It's the peel that they need to have Wolf at high health. Duke needs to get some tank items. He's kind of in that split push zone right now where you expect him to be that 1v2 raid boss, but he's just not actually shoving up the lanes to split pushable situations, because if they lose control of the mid lane, they lose control of the side lanes too, thanks to the Tom Kench. So Samsung kind of keeping the SKT composition handcuffed and unable to use their best tools.
And that's so important because of how pivotal Duke has been all four games leading up to this point. If Duke has to always think twice about an Abyssal Voyage delivering death behind him, it instantly gives advantage to Samsung, because they're not under that much or as much map pressure as they have been throughout the course of this best of five. I think he's going to need to ward hop to safety. We'll get the pink ward. That's his way out. 26 minutes, Kobe, and Samsung.
Still so close.
Again, marginal lead, but it is a knife's edge. There's no real advantage with the kill and the gold, because neither team's going past the river. Like, this is such shallow vision that is being fought over.
If there is, it's the fact that so much of the gold here is focused on these carries for Samsung. Ruler on the Jhin, especially, with the lion's share here.
Yeah. His last two Jhin games have been pretty exquisite. He had 9 kills in their last victory, 3 kills here.
And he shows why, you know, SKT in the beginning of the series prioritized taking it away from him.
Then Ash slips through, and, you know, even though Ash had exceptional results in the semifinals, it was also a pick that was largely ignored throughout a lot of the group stage in quarterfinals because of the substantial nerfs that Ash actually had before Worlds. But still successful Ash plays, just not this game with all the tools they have to prevent the Ash arrows from hitting true and leading to kills.
Taking a look at this river, Rune and Core JJ backing out. Catching a quick glimpse there of Crown, and when Crown won in the semi-final matchup, he was talking about looking forward to the finals and how if Samsung were going to win, Crown would have to be able to go toe-to-toe and step up to Faker. And undeniably, he's done so this series. Has a solo kill under his belt, has not been bullied in lane quite like Ryu was.
Just think back to the beginning of this series and how one-sided it started out, mm-hmm. with SKT almost completely destroying Samsung and even having a big lead in that deciding game where Samsung were able to stall it out 70 minutes.
This has almost been a tale of two series. You wonder how Samsung was able to turn it around, down 10,000 gold in game two to now be up in game five against SKT. It's miraculous, and SKT was pretty much running a victory lap. We were talking about their legacies coming in, and it seemed like it was a certainty, but they messed up at the Baron Pit. Samsung capitalized, and they've just been on fire ever since.
Will the Samsung legacy continue with a win? Will they be declared the 2016 World Champions? We're 30 minutes into the game. All of the summoners are now available once again. I ask the same question I did 10 minutes ago. Is the answer still the same? Vision and or initiation from these ultimates? Because nobody is playing risky right now. They're not trying to push an advantage.
This game is always about vision and initiation. Risk tolerance, risk versus reward, how well you execute those plays. With an Infernal Drake now being up, it's all about this lower Drake pit, but can they get a pick beforehand? The answer is no. That gives SKT the ability to move in for some vision.
Such an important ultimate there, burned from Samsung for almost nothing as SKT, you know, Wolf puts up the Unbreakable and they're able to weather the storm. Now they have a huge advantage. Their Ash Arrow still available to make a pick.
Ambition not holding Olaf, on though. As long as he can. Here comes Core JJ. Kick back. Ambition now throws down the Ragnarok. No Devour just yet, but this will
capitalize
on the Infernal Drake.
Castle.
Secured by SKT. Ash Arrow onto Crown. Core JJ eats him, then flashes away. Crown survives with his life. TP wasted and Dragon to SKT.
Cuvée is still pushing in the top lane, and Duke does have Teleport. He can easily go back to Fountain and catch those minions, so Samsung don't even get any map pressure out of that. That being said, there was a little bit of, you know, miscoordination from SKT there as they, you know, half of them go for the Dragon, whereas Bangi is using Flash Ultimate on Lee Sin to get a pick, but Bang is DPSing Dragon, not there to finish off the kill. They do get the objective in the end. We can tell how tense it is for these players and how quickly they're making these decisions. Not even time to alert the other member.
And you really have to just take your hat off to these guys. We've been 5.5 hours they've been in these chairs playing these games, trying to decide who will be the world champion. And with plays like that, getting the third Drake against Samsung, getting some of that late game scaling, but still not having the gold, maybe not even having the initiation tools, but having the ability to disengage, we could still be in for many more minutes of League of Legends.
And an Infernal Drake at that, at post 30 minutes. Huge value there in the pickup.
With Elder Dragon being the next one. This time around, a little bit more damage from the Curtain Call, but the Unbreakable blocks so much.
Yep.
Wolf doing wonders with this brawl.
They're throwing it out for the flows to look for those picks. Not finding it, and that once again gives initiation advantage over to SKT with their Ash Arrow. Samsung setting up wards though, so they didn't, it wasn't a useless ultimate. They got into the red quadrant, placed the wards, and now they're actually trying to sneak in.
They're scouted.
They are indeed. Hawkshot comes out. Abyssal Voyage was used, so I think 4JJ jumped over the back of the pit. Ambition once again holding onto that Ragnarok, waiting for the Devour. Gravity Field holds him in place, but SK Telecom, never stop it. The amount of free vision that you get with those Hawk shots cannot be understated in this caliber of play.
And I can hear it in your voice, Quickshot. This game is so tense right now. I don't know if we've ever had a more tense experience in a World Final.
We have where... not.
Correct. Maybe even in League of Legends, only because of what's at stake. It's a World Championship right now, and we're 1,600 gold different, 32 minutes into the game, with matched team compositions that have relatively equal scaling. The entire year can hinge on a single moment.
And the two people battling, it's like the prince and the pauper. You cannot be further apart in terms of their histories and their stories coming into this. SK Telecom on the verge of being defeated by Samsung Galaxy.
Not even just the entire year of these two teams. The entire year of every team that's been eliminated from Worlds, all watching and waiting. Oh, Bangi going in for a little duel there here with their Ambition.
Well, trading a little bit back and forth, gonna kill the Invisible Ward. Will regen.
Faker's ghosting.
Ash Arrow, where will it go? Bang, looking for the target, connects.
They burst.
JJ stunned out. Bangi is gonna kick him backwards. Core JJ's down. Teleport canceled again by Cuvée.
So big for them to also get the teleport out there in addition to the kill for SKT, and they're starting to close in. Now, vision still in favor of Samsung, so SKT, whoa.
But I also wonder how much the history of this series will be in the back of SKT's mind. They started losing this series when they forced a Baron. Normally, when SKT gets a pick on someone like that, they are relentless with forcing Baron. Yet they scatter now. They go back to controlling ways. They don't even look at the Baron.
Well, you have to do your homework here. You have to dig step number one, which is clear out the vision. That's just a support kill. It's a support kill on a Tahm Kench who can Abyssal Voyage back to the Baron pit.
Bangi taxes out again, safeguard. Baron is the only thing these teams are looking at. With 35 minutes in, Duke is finally pushing down the bottom lane. It's the first time he's gone sort of past that river in what feels like 10 or 15 minutes. The threat of the engage from Core JJ has kept him at bay, and Core JJ is
devoured
and hit the wrong man. Whew.
Oh yeah, that's what Tahm Kench does.
Yeah.
That's what Bang is thinking. All right, they're not.
Oh, Crown is really low.
A lot of damage from the Chaos Storm. Core JJ is going to gobble him up. That will block the next few ticks, and it's coming apart at the hinges. SKT getting more and more and more.
Olaf is incredibly useless without the ultimate and Ghost this late in the game. This team doesn't have extra speed for him, so Ambition is going to be waiting for those cooldowns to come back up before he can have any sort of meaningful impact in the team fight now. And SKT, these small advantages adding up and up.
And you're wondering when they can actually spill over into a real advantage, because they actually, despite getting all their ass, haven't controlled vision at the Baron pit, and they're not looking to burst it down. It's actually Samsung who is pushing back up towards the mid lane because Faker's in the side wave.
Well, this time around, Wolf is not there to block off the curtain call. The final shot from Whisper is being held a very long time, finally blocked off. Here comes Bengi,
kicks back.
There's no Ragnarok, loses his life. They've traded jungler for jungler. They only send Wolf away. Cubase caught up on the gravity field, forced to flash defensively, trading lives of junglers and a few ultimates as well.
And where will the advantages trigger over? Junglers trade their lives because Bengi walks through for a kick while taking her ass. SKT with the much higher health bars.
Yeah, and I would have thought that they would have transitioned down to the Drake after that, but they make a beeline for this brush to try and make a brush play on Samsung. Not gonna work though, and they lose out on a bit of the time where they did have some momentum.
He gets devoured by Core JJ's in so much trouble. Flashes away to safety. Curtain call not up, and Core JJ dies. Why were they so far forward?
Ruler has done that multiple times, gets super aggressive when unnecessary. This costs his team tremendously. Core JJ sacrifices life and Baron control.
This could be where the advantages spill over. Cubase does have a teleport, but SKT have Baron at half, and they have the vision control.
Here comes Cubase and Crown. Petrifying Gaze is available. It's now a 2v4. Flash!
Oh, into the throw!
It's in so much trouble. Concussive blows. Get to Petrifying Gaze. That's just going to delay the inevitable. Crown goes down!
Flashes in alive! The tension just overwhelms Samsung right there. It's Baron, it's two deaths, it's SKT moving towards the other Drake, or will they just take the dead Cassiopeia to try and get turrets?
These players that are new to the championship stage at the critical moments, Ruler makes a mistake, Crown flashes in a line, and SKT punished heavily.
No flash over the wall for an Elder Drake steal on the Olaf. Huge swing for the veterans SKT as they try and secure their third world championship.
Just a mistake. Look at this flash.
Oh, straight line. He didn't want to flash out because that takes him farther away from the base, and he wasn't close enough to the wall to flash over it, but you still don't flash in a straight line when the Ash Arrow is coming at you, and SKT immediately transitioned there for the Elder Drake, and now they have their first real advantage of the game. 5,000 gold. Can they close it?
Samsung did not give up earlier in the series, and they will not give up that easily. They still have a full line of secondary turrets to work through before getting to the inhibitor one. And yes, I do expect SKT to get a massive amount of gold off of this play, as you can see with the Baron power play once again.
Still 2 minutes left on that timer.
Also, this is where the split push Trundle really wreaks havoc, because they can't stop him from killing the turrets, and 4v4, they can't stop the rest of them from killing the turrets, because Cubase is occupied in the side lane.
The SKT hype train coming into the station once again. Baron and Elder Dragon on them, taking down the inhibitor turret, snare onto Wolf.
Cubase and Duke fighting in the top lane, the 4v4 looking for opportunities. Bang still has the enchanted crystal arrow, flash and heal. Two Samsung Galaxy will be looking to take out him or Faker, and it's just such a tough toss. Crown's gone up top.
30 seconds left on this Elder Drake, so Samsung really don't want to get engaged in a fight, but they also really don't want to lose two inhibitors, so they might
jump on the Bang.
Let's take a look. Unbreakable Wills up on the front line. Ambition not going to use the Ragnarok or the Ghost. Curtain call. Not going to be enough to really bother SK Telecom. Wolf sidesteps into the final shot. That still doesn't matter.
Look at how disciplined SKT is trying to play right here. The curtain call comes up. It stalls their push. They actually lose the Elder Drake buff now and don't get any inhibitors down. Despite the 6,600 gold Baron power play, when you're dealing with the triple elemental Drake Elder, that actually, I think, is a good hold from Samsung, but there's still now a large hill for them to climb back in.
Definitely a well... Oh, Duke actually going to have to flash that one. But definitely a well above average Baron power play here for SKT, because the game was almost dead even when that mistake came in the mid lane from Ruler, and look how heavy the punishment is.
Yeah. Never bet against SKT. Faker picking the victor away from Crown. 5 kills, max items before 40 minutes, something he has done so many times this series. But this also means they can't let Samsung match him. They need to be able to use these max items to hammer home their edge.
Seems to be the case as SK Telecom are once again grouped up, using their numbers advantages.
Juve poked,
hanging out in the bottom lane, trying to deal with that minion wave. No wards to teleport into, so even though Faker was running low, this one pink ward, which all of SKT have already gotten away from. Samsung in a familiar place, down at 40 minutes.
Down, but not out. Not quite yet. And they continue to play the defensive vision game, clearing out the wards, immediately moving into their own jungle. But man, such a heavy gold swing so quickly. Will they be ready for the extra burst damage? Like, that was such a huge influx of gold. You know, Guardian Angel advantages have to be accounted for. Quicksilver Sashes recently picked up. Bang also has that one available.
Yeah, even the GA on Wolf. I want to think that Ruler needs to stay very far back. He has no magic resist on that Jhin, and Faker with the Lich Bane.
Far back, you say, eh?
Faker can one-shot him if he gets within flash range. That is what that Lich Bane Victor build does.
Well, Faker's played on the front foot. Faker's flashed aggressively with ultimates all day long.
Keep your eyes on Tahm Kench, though, because Core JJ can save a life. Core JJ can save the carries.
He needs to do more than that. He needs to deliver someone to take a life. Core JJ cannot play defensively if Samsung want to turn this one around.
The thing with the Core JJ ultimates at this point of the game is they either need to be at the end of fights or while SKT is split pushing. Because if you're going into a 5v5 with the Tahm Kench, you get wrecked on top of Victor's Gravity Field and Chaos Storm because you're actually just delivering free skill shot accuracy for Faker. A very difficult mode for Samsung to play right now.
Juve is able to sidestep those skill shots. 42 minutes. You could feel and cut the tension in the air as SK Telecom are now looking to close the game out. They have not had the cleanest of wins. SKT have made mistakes. They've been caught out of position and then they've overreached at times.
And this is their chance to end this game cleanly because they have almost a full item advantage on all of their players. Mm-hmm. Everybody on Samsung still needs to fill in an extra item, but the longer the game goes on, the closer Samsung work to that point where they even it up again and have another good shot at a team fight.
Yeah, and with the Baron coming up shortly, that's the moment where SKT need to kind of strike. Samsung's trying to get ward control, but this is where the biggest danger is going to be. This is the most likely SKT is here. You'd think to close it out and win their third world championship. Can they get the vision control? Can they get a pick if Samsung decides to stop them at Baron? And if they do get that pick, the game is likely over because they then have the Baron buff as well as dead members on Samsung. But they have to do it, and it's not going to be easy.
Samsung still in with a shot. Baron is up in 20 seconds. Elder Dragon probably about 40 to 60 away. Because, of course, SKT took both of them, one after the other. And we've seen a lot of split priority about which objective they want. Samsung this time around definitely wants that Baron buff. And they've only got a single Cloud Drake under their belt. It is not going to be as useful to them.
Baron has arrived. Again, the fight over wards leading into Baron once again will rage as SKT move in to clear them out, but crucially, Ambition got the Scuttle Crab, but even more crucially, has no ultimate for the team fight.
Yeah, but no one to haste him either. SKT immediately turn for the Baron right now.
Teleport
Olaf can't run for his steal.
The Baron's already secured, taken by SK Telecom. Juve finishes off the TP, turns around to try and help protect Ruler. Chaos Storm will allow Ambition. Seeing his GA popped. And Faker with SKT, they get another kill.
Beautifully done by SKT right there. Getting Ambition's ultimate and immediately going for Baron and then cutting off his charge.
This is Game 5 SK Telecom. The winningest team in world's history. led by Faker, the greatest competitor to ever play the game.
And they're closing, trying to get a pick. He's not there to clear the mid lane wave.
Faker is even going to sidestep
those pushes. Patient though. Faker's expecting him to be
anticipating it. He knows who he's up against. 25 seconds before Ambition respawns. Baron empowered minions, a super minion coming down the mid lane. In just a moment or two, as that inhib falls, SKT, they now turn their attention to the top lane. Bang takes a lot of damage, but it's Ruler that's forced to be devoured. Kyubey uses the verdict to buy some time. His GA is popped. Crown's looking for a target to use the petrifying gaze. Chaos Storm is almost up for Faker. The second inhibitor falls, and SKT back away. Samsung's base is broken.
SKT looking poised. Their play in the last 20 minutes has been very methodical and clean. They've taken a close game into a 13,000 gold lead and two downed inhibitors. They're definitely taking their time. They're doing it right.
The Guardian Angels are now down for Samsung. The two inhibitors are now down for Samsung. And this is their last chance.
Yeah, very tense moment here. So SKT has the two inhibitors down, looking for number three.
Well, I can see ZZROP portal in Wolf's inventory. Going to help continue putting pressure on those side lanes. As, of course, actually used to put pressure on the mid lane. So super minions coming down through the mid. Only one inhibitor left standing.
Yeah, and you'd think they'd want to try Desperation of Day, but they actually don't. They want to try and keep the waves at bay so they don't have to desperately engage. With the triple melee team composition, it's very hard to walk through SKT, as we've seen time and time again in this game. But with the Baron buff, the 13,000 gold, SKT are trying to push for the championship.
And there's three extra lives on SKT as they look for their third championship. Three Guardian Angels up and available to the one of Samsung Galaxy. Kyubey's running away. Faker's chasing him down with the Chaos Storm. Bengi's not going to find a target as Core JJ forced to devour Samsung Galaxy. They're running away with their lives.
And time is working against them. The minions are flooding in the base. SKT are knocking at the door.
It seems so close. The super minions now onto the Nexus turrets. Samsung have to respond. Curtain call to buy some time, but it only connects onto Duke. Ambition's not used the Ragnarok or the Ghost just yet. Nexus turret is under threat. A third inhibitor falls, and SK Telecom are doing this by the numbers.
They're just not giving windows for Samsung to engage. The only way Samsung could have gotten a flank is if Kyubey walks around. Faker burns his ultimate to take Kyubey low, just so that's an impossibility, and they're very well taking down every single inhibitor. Now they turn for Elder while they're defending the triple inhibitors. Beautiful.
SKT are waiting for the extra super minions to flood into the base while they take this Elder Dragon to return to claim their prize.
Now we were talking about the SKT victory lap in the Game 3 comeback when they had the 10,000 gold lead. This is more likely and closer than they've ever been to winning that third world championship. Elder Drake up, three inhibitors down, double spawns of super minions in every single wave. This would be the time for them to do it.
It feels like SK Telecom know exactly how to play against Samsung's team composition. The arrow this time goes between the goalposts. Kyubey's under threat. Deadly Flourish as Samsung are under pressure. This is buying time for those super minions to pour in. Kick around. Crown is able to flash so he doesn't get caught, but Kyubey's down.
And it's a war of attrition. They're just waiting for them. Wrecking them in a fight.
Duke flashes forward, chomps down to kill Crown. SK Telecom have got two. Make that three kills. The curtain call is a fitting end to the World Championship as Samsung Galaxy are being dove under their tower. SK Telecom have overcome every challenge. They are the undisputed best team in the world. The SKT reign continues. They win their third world championship.
And you better believe the crowd's giving a standing ovation after that one. This was an incredibly hard-fought series. SKT had to earn this one till the